Joining us for our next discussion is Dr. Dave Magaña, who is the Vice President and Senior Analyst at RaboResearch for Food and Agribusiness. Prior to joining Rabobank, he served as Deputy Director of Economic Research for FIRA at Banco de Mexico. He's conducted analysis on the agricultural sector for over a decade, one of our sources in the credit sector. And his research agenda and experience include agricultural market integration under the North American Free Trade Agreement, consumer trends in fresh fruit and vegetable markets, food security, and food price dynamics, among lots of other related topics which he'll share today. So please join me in welcoming David Magaña.
Thank you. When I was in grad school, my first year 20 years ago, and about to submit a term paper, one of my classmates asked the professor, how many pages should I write for the term paper? The answer I still remember today was, your term paper should be like your swimming suit. Should be long enough to cover the subject and should be short enough to keep it interesting. So I remember that today because the topic that I'm about to cover is, to say it's challenging, it is an understatement. So I'm trying to cover a perspective on a drought, inflation, and labor challenges, and a lot has been written about that. And I will try to keep an optimistic perspective, which is an increasingly difficult commodity to find in these times. So before that, by the way, thank you for the invite and introduction. Something that was not included in my bio is that I'm a farm boy. I grew up in a farm, and I can proudly say that I've been involved with agriculture all my life. So I'm about to start now with my slides, but before that, I'd like to ask you a question. Who here in the audience likes to go hunting? A few. Good. I was expecting probably less people, but it's good that you like go hunting. Do you like go dog hunting? Yes, all right. How about goose hunting? Yes, okay, still the answer is yes. What about swan hunting? That's illegal, right? Let's go a little bit more exotic than that. What about black swan hunting? No? Do they exist? They do. What about, just one last question, what about gray rhino hunting? Nobody, right? Because if you like black swan hunting or gray rhino hunting, guess what? You're in luck because those have been in season for a while. And let me tell you what I mean by that, and I have here the definition. A black swan event is an unpredictable event that is beyond what is normally expected of a situation and has potentially severe consequences. So black swan events are characterized by their extreme rarity, severe impact, and the widespread insistence that they were obvious after they happened. And that is called because they thought they didn't exist until they saw one black swan. So examples of these black swan events are 9/11 events, the global financial crisis of 2008-2009, the 2014 oil crisis, Brexit, and events like that. On the other hand, a gray rhino is a probable event with a great deal of impact, which is often ignored, neglected, or minimized. So the gray rhino is a risk or danger that is obvious, is visible, is common, and still you decide not to take action on that, right? Examples of that are geopolitics, monetary policy of central banks, sustainability, new technologies. What about Sigma? What about droughts, more persistent droughts? What about the COVID-19 pandemic? Some people say that the COVID-19 pandemic was not a black swan because we've had pandemics before. We had the Spanish flu pandemic 100 years ago. We've had the SARS pandemic and other pandemics as well. So a pandemic is not a black swan. However, I argue that the combination of factors that came together within the last 2 years should be considered a black swan. So now we have not only the pandemic, we have also geopolitics, we have logistic challenges, we have inflation. The way how the government responded to the pandemic was unprecedented. Unlike any other economic downturns, during this time, the disposable income not only didn't go down, but it was a record high, which created inflationary pressures that we're feeling today, right? So we're in the middle of a perfect storm, and now I have to add Sigma, the drought, and things like that. So those have been challenges that have been in place for years, and I will touch on those a little bit. So we have this massive collision between the demand side pressures and supply side constraints that have been in place for years and will continue to be the case. So on the one hand, we have increasing, rising incomes in many countries, particularly in developing countries, where middle class is growing fast. And now I often hear, before the pandemic, it was more often, we had the challenge of feeding a growing population, about 9 billion people by 2050. That is already a formidable challenge. But add to that equation that those consumers will not only be more people to feed, but they will have increasing incomes, and they will be demanding different type of foods. So they will be demanding more protein, they will be demanding more products with the, what we call the trifecta, products that have healthful attributes, that are convenient, that are tasty, and things like that. On the other hand, we have all these constraints on the supply side. Land constraints, water constraints, regulatory constraints, labor and logistical challenges as well. So it seems that we have these seemingly contradictory desires, right? Consumers, on the one hand, they want more food, year-round fresh food, but at the same time, they want it to be local. They want better quality fresh food, but at the same time, they want more organics. They want more convenience, but at the same time, less plastic. And they want the food to be affordable, even in the presence of all these supply-side challenges. So this collision will continue to create opportunities, challenges, and change. And on top of that, we have geopolitics and now the situation in Europe, which we all felt the impact on energy prices, fertilizer prices, and other inputs as well. So, but let's put this into perspective. Is this something new that the agriculture is facing now that is completely new? Probably not. If here in front of you, you have a couple of very familiar faces, right? Everybody knows these two guys. If you don't, just pretend you do. You will look smart. So everybody knows probably the guy on the right. my kids made me watch those movies. And I didn't realize all that war, Infinity War and all that, it was because of a discrepancy on a policy, right? So it was a policy-driven war. And let me just talk to you a little bit about the guy on the left-hand side. Anybody knows him? No? Thomas Malthus. He was very famous. His probably the most famous book was The Principle of Population that was published in 1798. Basically, he is a famously pessimistic English thinker, and he was saying back then that the humanity was doomed to destruction because population at that point was growing faster than food production. What was the population back then? 1 billion people, right? Now we are 8 billion people, and we're still trying to survive these challenges. So back to that. He was saying, like, even proposing some very drastic measures, such as you should stop handing out food to low-income families because that will create the incentive to bring more mouths to feed. And he was also proposing to create chemical castration because he was saying our love for food and sex is a recipe for disaster because the population will continue to grow. And just food production is not growing at the same pace. Thanos, on the other hand, he was proposing what? To eliminate, like that, with 50% of the population in the universe, because there was not enough resources to feed everyone. So the 50% left could have better living conditions. So either it was from actual thinking or fiction, we've been thinking about this pessimistic view for more than 200 years. You look back 100 years, what were the main challenges of California agriculture 100 years ago? Water, labor, and transportation. What are the main challenges today? Water, labor, transportation, and many others. Different names, different magnitudes, but the same challenges still. And we are not only 1 billion people as in Malthus's time, but we are 8, and we're still trying to increase food production. So now, to touch a little bit on the drought situation, everyone is familiar with this. Drought is impacting acreage, yields, crop mix, and cost of water, etc. And unlike the previous drought from 2014 that ended just before the 2017 calendar year, some of the main differences back then was Sigma was not in place yet. The other one was input costs were not as expensive. And yes, we had lower yields, but prices of commodities, including, for example, let's say almonds, they were significantly higher as they are now. So now we're facing a more challenging environment. And now in the current drought last year, if you see the red, the D3, which is extreme drought, the proportion of the state under this condition was already higher than in the previous drought. Then we had rain in December, and December brought us hope. However, then you all know the story. We've had some of the driest years in 2022. Now this is the situation as of June 28th, and you see that shrimp-like shape in the Central Valley, in the east part of Tulare, Fresno, and Madera counties. Part of that is in the mountains, as we had way below average snowpack, and obviously on the west side of the valley. So the proportions of the state under the condition, you are very familiar with this. But I will touch a little bit on the economic impact. The University of California was estimating that because of Sigma, over the next two or three decades, about 1 million acres of irrigated land will need to be fallowed. That was the estimate for the next two or three decades. However, the same University of California, in a different study, estimated that in 2021, one of the economic impacts of the drought last year was that already 400,000 acres were fallowed, right? So probably we're approaching that million acreage of fallow land sooner rather than later. Also, the cost of water. We all knew that Sigma was coming, but now we've seen water restrictions implemented sooner rather than later. Now, in the most critically overdrafted regions, they are now restricting even groundwater use and penalizing for the use of more water. So now we are seeing more orchards being pulled out and more acreage being fallowed. So I will touch in the next few slides what's been happening in terms of what is expected to happen in terms of changes in yields and change in crop mix. So this is a study that I'm citing at the top, at the bottom of the slide, and is showing the expected yields for the next two, three, or even four next decades. As you see, they are expecting declining yields. So this is the estimated crop yield changes associated with future climate scenarios with yield anomalies from compared to the baseline, which is 2000 and 2003 average yields in percent. So you see the black line that shows the median projections, and the dark shaded area shows the 90% confidence interval after accounting for climate uncertainty, and the light shaded area shows a 90% confidence interval after accounting for both climate and crop uncertainty. So, do you agree in general with this? For example, table grapes, declining yields. They're expecting up to 20% lower yields in the next few decades compared to the baseline of 2000. I think they're missing one point, as our old friend Malthus was not considering one important thing. And according to Malthus, we should be all dead by now, right? Because we're a lot of people. So he was not taking into consideration what? Technical change, innovation. And probably these people are not considering also the power of innovation, genetic improvements. You will have table grape production in California has remained the same, even though acreage has been down. So now you will see the power of genetics and lower, more input efficient cultivars, higher quality and higher yields. So this should be the norm going forward. So probably that's one aspect also to consider. In terms of almonds, everyone is familiar. A lot of challenges over the last two or three years. Now not only the freeze, but deficit irrigation, and now USDA is expecting lower than average yields this year. And I'm not trying to picture sugar-coated all the challenges, but what I'm trying to do is just to say we need to continue innovating to continue with this production. Now, in terms of change in crop mix, we see that in general, farmers will continue to allocate water to the higher economic value use. And in that sense, on the left panel, I'm showing the gross returns per bearing acreage in the US for the last two decades for almonds, pistachios, and walnuts. And in general, this industry has been favored compared to, for example, stone fruits and other industries where you have not only the water challenge, but also the labor challenge. And in the right panel, I'm showing the growth in these tree nut industries compared to 2000. So the bearing acreage for walnuts by 2026, we're expecting to be twice that of 2000. For that of almonds, about three times, and pistachios, almost seven times that of 2000. Here you see that walnuts, almonds, and pistachios are in different stages of development, with the fastest growth in terms of pistachios. This is in percentage terms. We need to keep in mind that in absolute terms, almonds will continue to be the most economically significant industry in the tree nut space. Looking at more like the broader picture in terms of fresh fruits, this chart is showing you the dynamics in terms of consumption for a lot of fruits and nuts. On the left side, you see the fastest growing categories, raspberries, pistachios, blueberries, avocados, mandarins, limes, and the like, right? And this includes domestic production and also imports. Obviously, we will continue to see increasing imports, particularly raspberries during the US off season, a lot of blueberries coming now from Peru. So we will see more competition for US crops in the blueberry space, in avocados, in table grapes coming from Peru, which, by the way, has transitioned from a country with just the potential or the opportunity to later being the rising star in the industry, now to be a powerhouse in terms of fruit exports. What did they do? They didn't have water on the coast, on the Pacific coast. So they diverted some of the water that naturally flows into the Amazon River and eventually reaches the Atlantic Ocean. They drilled the Andy Mountains, and they diverted portion of that water, and now they're a powerhouse in the fruit industry. A couple of months ago, I was in this conference where a person was proposing, what about if we divert only 10% of additional water that goes freely to the ocean here in California? That should be enough to compensate for all the overdrafting. So that was his estimate, not mine. On the other hand, we see in the right hand some of the stone fruit and prunes and plums and prunes, which have strategically reduced acreage in California. So here you see the picture of what could happen in the what trends are likely to continue to happen. And just to show also on the vegetable side, these are the trends, obviously. More availability of kale, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, and the commodities that you see there. So if these trends continues, then you will see how you can have an idea of the crop mix that we will have in the future. Now, going into the inflationary pressures, an economist with the Federal Reserve in San Francisco did this decomposition of the core inflation in the US. And I found this very, very interesting, because now we have inflationary pressures, and we all know that some of that is coming from the supply side, some of that is coming from the demand side. So he did this decomposition. I don't want to go into the technical details, but he was able to see how much is demand driven, because we were having higher disposable income and demanding more, and how much of that is supply driven, how much of that is input cost increasing, labor cost increasing, and energy cost increasing as well, right? So you have there that demand-driven inflation is kind of stabilizing or starting to decline. And on the other hand, supply-driven inflation continues to increase. The ambiguous part of that is like he didn't have statistically significant parameters to either pin down if that was because of supply side, demand-driven inflation or supply-driven. This is relevant now that the Fed is increasing interest rates. And what is the objective of these increasing interest rates? So is to control the demand-driven inflation, because now it's going to be more expensive to get a credit either for consumption, for investment, and things like that. But monetary policy does nothing on the supply-driven inflation. And that is quite relevant, because now, as I said, innovation should be the answer. Now it will be increasingly costly to be investing to create this innovation that we need. So these are the Fed's dot plot that shows what are the perspective in terms of interest rates. And everyone knows that now is about 1.75, and many of the people expect that by the end of 2022, the Fed interest rate will be close to 3.5. Then by 2023, we'll be reaching probably 3.75, and then decline, expected to decline in 2024 as inflation should be declining at that point. So that's in terms of inflationary pressures. The monetary policy will be kind of reducing the demand side, but not the supply side that will be here for a while. In terms of drivers impacting some of the supply side, not only ocean freights, but also energy and fertilizers, now we see that three or the four major forces continue to have upward pressure on prices. But now we have inflation and consumer confidence now in the opposite direction. So ocean freight rates continue to decline, and also fertilizers are starting to decline, but they will not go back to pre-pandemic levels. To finish this in the next 5 minutes, I will touch on the labor situation. And everybody is feeling this during the pandemic. The last 2 years, a lot of sectors were struggling with enough labor, the hospitality industry, all across the board. However, for agriculture, that's been a challenge for years, and we've been feeling that. My point is that, at least in agriculture, this will not be resolved anytime soon, if ever, given the demographic changes, economic changes, and generational changes that I'm about to present. First off, it's no secret to anyone that agriculture, and in particular California agriculture, has relied on immigrant labor, particularly coming from Mexico, either with proper documentation or without it. But you see that for farming, probably more than 50% are immigrants. And for California, I bet that is quite higher than that. So now what's been happening with these immigrants, particularly those that came without documents? And we've seen the trend that in all US and particularly in California, that just before the pandemic, the unauthorized immigrant population was reached the minimum since 1995. So these are obviously estimates, because by definition, you cannot observe how many people are here without documents. But what you can observe are the apprehensions at the US southern border by origin. You see Mexican nationals sharply declining over the last two decades, And now people coming from other origins, including Central America and some of the Caribbean. And not only the nationality has been changing, but also the percentage of apprehension you have also by type. Just a decade ago, a lot of people were single adults coming to work temporarily and then go back. But now you see increasingly more family units or even accompanied children. Here you will see the demographic changes. In the left panel, obviously, employment in agriculture declines as you have economic development. You have the example of China, example of Mexico, really declining from about 25% to half of that in a matter of just a decade and a half. And on the right-hand panel, you see that a lot of people that used to come to work in agriculture were coming from West Central Mexico or Central Mexico. And you see this is the predicted probability of working in agriculture but rural regions in Mexico. So you live in rural areas and you don't work with in agriculture. And that probability has declined sharply over the last two or three decades. So you will not have people with experience working in agriculture. So that's definitely declining. On the other hand, even if you have workers living still in Mexico and are willing and able also to work in agriculture, now they have more agricultural jobs available in Mexico. As you see there, a lot of these labor-intensive crops are increasingly being grown in Mexico and exported to the U.S. to the U.S. market, particularly berries, avocados, and all those vegetables. So going forward, someone could think, like, what can we do in terms of immigration policy? Any immigration policy won't be able to change these changes in fertility rate, for example. Natality rate declined sharply in Mexico from almost seven people per, children per family to about two. Just as an example, I had eight siblings. In growing up in Central Mexico, and I had just two kids. So you see that replicated in millions and millions of families. So what that means that in the next few years, the cohort of people, young people from 15 to 35 years old, then is going to be declining. Besides that, the migration from Mexico has been below zero for the last decade. On top of that, we have this generational change. I'm not going to talk about millennials because you've heard a lot of, I'm sure you have heard a lot of presentations about millennials over the last few years. So I'm talking about the next generation, Gen Z or centennials. And now in centennials, one out of four centennials in the US are of Hispanic origin. They are more likely to be the second or third generation of immigrants, but they are not going to be willing to work in agriculture as their parents did, right? Now they are more educated than ever before. And that is definitely an opportunity for agriculture, not a challenge, but an opportunity. As I said, innovation has always been the answer, but the equation is now more complicated. We have more variables in place, including all the constraints that at the same time you have the high consumer expectations, but at the same time we have more tools. We have these more educated kids that can bring new technologies and new innovation to the agricultural industry. So to conclude, I'm still optimistic about California agriculture and the way we can innovate to overcome all these challenges, as well as in the bank, we are also committed to agriculture and agribusiness 100%. So I ended up with a commercial after all. So thank you for your attention and happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
So I'm sorry that we're out of time, but there was a quick question, if we can have a quick answer. And that had to do with how you came about with some of the acreage expectations for the crops that were going to be declining in acreage. Was that from another study?
Yeah.
That
For the University of California, one famous study, they estimated that about 1 million acres needed to be followed in the next two or three decades because of the implementation of Sigma. And in another study, the University of California estimated that in 2021 only, there was almost 400,000 acreage that were followed because of water challenges.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Let's join together and thank him again for his comments.